Welcome to the Forward Foundation. I'm Darren Walker, and I have the great privilege of serving as president of the Forward Foundation. And it is indeed an honor on this occasion because we get to talk about art, something I am very passionate about. And we get to talk about art with two people who know a lot about art, I think. First, we have Christopher Liu. Chris Liu, welcome to the Forward Foundation. Tschabalala Self, Shaba, welcome to the Forward Foundation. I'm really, really happy you're both here, and you're here because of this tome, Prime. Prime is the compilation of the next generation of artists working on the front lines, creating all sorts of extraordinary works in all forms of media. So I want you to both talk about this book and your role, because you had a lot to do with who's in this book. So, Chris, why don't I start with you?
Sure. So I was asked to be one of the nominators for the publication by Keith Fox, who was so kind to reach out. And really, the nominators were primarily curators at institutions. At the time, I was at the Whitney Museum. I had left just not some months ago. And also, I believe, writers and other people with institutional affiliations. And then we all thought about names of exciting emerging artists that were no older than 40. And then that was then passed along to the Phaidon editors, and then which resulted in the artist like Shaba being in there.
Great. So, and Shaba, talk about what it feels like as an artist and the role that this book is going to play, hopefully, in your career.
Well, it's very exciting to be in the book. It's really important for artists to kind of forge their own path, but it's equally as important to be in context with peers, because you really understand an artist fully historically when you see who they're making work in relation to. So a book like this is very, very important for that reason, really placing an artist within a particular context. And books have a certain kind of reach that other things do not. A show is up for a period of time. People enter it, they leave. A lot of people are heavily invested in social media, mm-hmm. which has a very ephemeral nature. Mm-hmm. But a book is something that people can have a very intimate relationship with, and they can have it in their homes, and they can come back to it at different points in their own life. So to always be in a book is a unique experience, and one that I'm very thankful to have.
So talk about your practice as an artist.
Well, my practice is primarily dedicated to figuration. I consider myself a painter, even though collage and assemblage are a big part of my making. I call all of my works paintings despite how they're made, because they exist on the substrate of a canvas. And I also am primarily interested in having that kind of dialogue with other paintings in an art historical context. And also, some of my favorite artists are painters, so I've always seen myself like in that trajectory. But yeah, that's kind of where my art is right now. I've been branching off into different mediums more lately, but even when working in different mediums, I'm thinking about approaching those projects from the philosophy of painting. So thinking about things in relation to themselves. So a lot of times people say that painting is really about putting one thing next to the other. So if I'm doing a performance or a sculpture or a sound work, I'm still thinking about how does one object or idea become changed when it's placed in relation to another one.
There's a lot of installation, though, where I often think about your work as painting, but often in an environment that you're creating.
Mm-hmm. 100%. Like, I've been trying to think about how to not just, how to curate an entire experience for a viewer, so they're not just entering, they can enter a space where the paintings are at that's all kind of pointing them towards the same emotion or ideas, not just having this singular experience of a work on the wall. Mm-hmm. So just really kind of controlling like every aspect of their interaction with the work, what's around it, their mood, everything they see in the periphery while experiencing in that work. So that's when the installation comes in hand.
And for you, Chris, as a curator, did you see among this, what are the commonalities and what What are the real divergences in the approaches of this next generation of artists?
Yeah, I mean, when you bring together like so many artists, it's hard to find a complete through line through everything. Everyone is coming with, you know, their own concerns and own responses to the world. One thing that I've thought about, though, is that I feel like there's a lot of storytellers within the kind of collection of artists. You know, it's interesting to hear like Shaba talk about the work with that kind of environment. Remember seeing images of the show you had in London some years ago where it was like a bodega installation. Mm-hmm. You know, so it really kind of created this like context and almost like story around the paintings themselves that sat within it. And there's so many artists that, you know, whether they're dealing with abstraction or more figuration or other things that you know, that there is this idea around storytelling and context that's so important. Mm-hmm. I would say the departure is, you know, thinking about artists that are like deeply indebted with materials, like Shaba, you know, it's very analog. And then you have other artists that are really thinking about technology or just, you know, working, their studio is a computer screen, you know, and it's a vastly different way of working. But still, I think it's, there is that thread around some kind of storytelling, I think, through many of the artists.
Yeah. And Shaba, for you, one of the real challenges of being an artist is, especially living in New York, mm-hmm. and working here, the whole question of commerce and the mercantilian nature of art ecosystem in a place like New York City. How does an artist keep her integrity in the midst of all of this?
Well, I'm from New York. I grew up here, but after I went to graduate school in New Haven, I stayed there actually, and I've kept my studio there for all these many years. I graduated in 2015, mm-hmm. and I'm going to be moving from New Haven this year, but I'm not moving back to New York. I'm actually going to be moving to Catskill, where it's closer to where I actually have my personal residence. Mm-hmm. At the moment, I moved to upstate New York, mm-hmm. so I think actually physically having that distance has been great for me. I've always felt like it's important to have my work in New York, because mm-hmm. New York is like, you know, it is, in my opinion, the biggest city in the world, the most important city in the world. It's also my hometown. So this is a city where I've gotten all of my inspiration from, to be honest, like all of my like ideas and desire and drive. But me personally, it's nice to kind of have a retreat, to have a place that's a little bit more quiet to actually make my work and kind of decompress, and also not to be so much like in the mix of all of those, like all of that transaction. I think it can be very distracting, but it's just about, it's like any other experience. You have to just create boundaries for yourself and be able to ground yourself in things that are actually important to you. For me, my work has always been the most important thing for me. I feel like my work is what's going to kind of outlive all of that noise. So just me having my studio have a little bit distance from the city, mm-hmm. has been one way I've kind of physically removed myself from a lot of that energy.
Well, there's something here. So you said that the fantasies and attitudes surrounding the Black female body are both accepted and rejected within your practice. And through this disorientation, new possibilities arise. So what motivates you to reclaim these difficult histories?
Well, I feel like it's always been something I've had to contend with in just developing my own self-image and trying to kind of place myself within the larger culture. I've had to contend with all the ideas that exist about Black femininity that already kind of precede me, you know, my own existence. So I think that I've obviously absorbed a lot of these beliefs because I grew up in this culture and this society, but I've also worked to dispel the ones I felt were damaging, ones I felt like were there to kind of consume me. So I feel like in my practice, I'm trying to create new narratives, but also kind of eat back the narratives mm-hmm. that I feel like are trying to eat at me, and maybe try to fold them into something that's more positive, something greater, something more expansive, something truer than what's been presented to me or projected upon me, or people who had similar lived experiences that I've had. And that's a mission statement that I wrote very, very early on in my, you know, artistic journey and career. And I've kept it, even though my work has in various times gone in different directions. I do feel like that's kind of the core essence of my mission. So it truly is a mission statement. I have different projects that, you know, contend with different ideas, but that's a kind of my core objective.
Right. And Chris, so as a curator, and as you've been a curator at one of the most important museums in America, the Whitney Museum of American Art, now you're a part of this project. So just to be clear, this book, Prime Art's Next Generation, so you have 100 artists, and all under the age of 40. How, I mean, I know as a curator, and you've lived in New York, and now you live in L.A.,
I'm going back and forth, still here.
Good, so you're bi-coastal. We like that even better. The work of a curator to be able to stay on top of, and often the next generation, younger artists, is even more work. So talk about, as a curator, what your practice is to be able to be in a position to nominate people. I mean, I could nominate five artists under 40. I mean, in terms of just off the top of my, I mean, how do you do that?
Well, I mean, it's interesting to hear Shaba say you need that kind of distance away from the hubbub of everything going on in the art world. As a curator, it's kind of the opposite, because you need to be out looking at exhibitions. You need to be in artist studios to see what they're doing. You need to see what your institutional peers are doing at museums. And that's, say, in New York, where there is so much, but also everywhere else as much as possible, you know, across the nation and internationally, you know, if you can. So when I was at the Whitney, I was overseeing the Emerging Artist Program, so was really kind of putting forward that line of exhibitions that you would typically see in the smaller size galleries that often introduce like an artist practice to a kind of broad audience in that sense. So in many ways, like, my job was to be able to kind of be that kind of talent scout and find artists early in their career and give them that kind of big opportunity in that sense. So a lot of it really comes through talking to a lot of artists. Like, nobody works kind of in a bubble. You know, you go to school, artists go to school with each other, their closest readers of their own work or viewers are often the people that they've known for a long time, and those are the people that you often trust even as you kind of move along in one's career. So a lot of the times you would visit somebody and then they would say, oh, my friend has an exhibition here, or you should check this out. So-and-so organized a small group show, you know, that could be off the radar. And you just kind of try to get out and see as much as possible and keep your ears open in that way. Not everything that you find is exciting. Oftentimes, especially when you're looking at work that is still really fresh and artists that are, I would say, not just young, because you could be emerging at any age, not just at this like 40.
Oh, really?
You know?
Thank you.
You know,
thank you. I love this.
So
you
can emerge.
So you can be emerging at 90.
Yeah.
Okay. You know,
it just will
like
be a different
that.
Book.
There's hope for me. But Chris, how when you think about this book, you know, 100 artists, but talk about the ones, I mean, are there any that you just want to say, hey, you ought to know about in this book, this artist or that artist?
I mean, there's so many, it's hard to pick out one. You know, one person that I'm very excited about is Fierle Baez, who's in the book, and incredible painter.
Not a fan here, collector, yes.
Also moving into installation in a really ambitious way. She had a great show at the ICA Boston across the harbor there not long ago. And somebody that's really, and I talked about storytelling before, she's really interested in thinking about Caribbean mythology, kind of deities coming from the region and putting that into her paintings, but also thinking historically, where she's going deep into archival research, looking at various maps and floor plans of, and also plans of cities going back centuries, and then putting her paintings kind of onto those photo montages of the maps. So it's collapsing these various ideas of belief and history, and in many ways kind of speaking back to, say, what dominant culture has kind of repressed or tried to, you know, change and seek out. So in that way, she's someone that is really excited to kind of see where she's grown. Coincidentally, I had been the curator for the Al Jaira Emerge program. This was over a decade ago, which is a kind of like professional building program in Newark. It's very similar to like the Bronx Artist in the Marketplace program, that's a little bit more well known. And so she was part of that cohort where I was invited to do the group show of that group. And so it was amazing to kind of see where she started back way back then. And now she's turned into this kind of star artist, even still at a young age.
Right. Any others?
You know, somebody else that's very close to is Kevin Beasley, who I worked with at the Whitney for a solo show. And, you know, for him, you know, the impetus for that exhibition was like an idea that he had in graduate school. So this is something that he had been holding on to for close to 10 years, where he had bought this electric motor that ran on a cotton gin farm in Alabama and wanted to get it going again and use the sound to create this installation and this very elaborate thing. And so when I first met him, he had just moved to New York after going to Yale. And he was talking about it then. And over the years, he kept talking about it and got to a point where it was like, let's just do this. You know, it's like you spent enough time thinking about it, like, let's try to realize it. And so that's somebody else that I feel is just, you know, every project that he does kind of just pushes even further. You think you know what he's doing. And then the next thing you know, he's got like a public garden in New Orleans, you know, and just keeps moving in a really exciting way.
Yeah. I mean, as an artist in both the examples, their work, their practice has just evolved and continues. There's no formula when you look at the arc of their work. I think it's time for questions, and I am sure for these two amazing people there are audience members who have queries for them. So we are going to open up the floor to this group, and you don't look like wallflowers to me. So I'm hoping that you will just step up and step to the mic and just tell us your name and ask Chris or Tschaba, your question, and I know you're shy, but please, thank you.
Hi, this is Paula. I had a question for Tschaba, which I like asking young artists. Are there any unrealized projects that you are kind of dreaming to do, and kind of now in your new studio, you think you'll work on, just kind of what you think might take you in the future, or is that just something you're still planning and thinking and want to keep to yourself?
Good question.
I mean, yeah, there are many projects that I would like to realize in the future. I think at some point I would like to kind of pursue the idea of like a narrative piece and maybe work in the medium of film. So that's something that I've been exploring with a couple of friends, because after doing the Performa Commission, I realized that when it comes to film and theater, that's really more of a collaborative exercise and needs quite a few people involved. So that's something that I hope I can do at some point. I don't know when, but you know, some point in the future.
Please, we have another question.
Sorry about that. my name is Gordon Skinner. Hey, Darren.
Hi, Gordon.
So I want to preface it by saying that art changes an individual. Individuals change societies, which makes all art political. And so the question is, with the artist being the truest barometer of the human condition, how are you all, as an institution, as a curator, as an artist, challenging yourselves, challenging the medium, to actually respond to the current malaise that we find ourselves in?
Good question. Want to go, curator?
Sure.
Thank you.
This will be maybe a slightly tangential response, but what I'll say, I think art moves slowly in the way that you've explained, where it's one individual putting out things that are received by an audience, and that slowly can transform a society in that sense. I think the important thing, especially when you're kind of thinking about the contemporary moment, you know, we're living in a moment that, especially now, is so tumultuous, it's very hard. We don't really understand what we're in until it's past and there's some hindsight to look back to it and then kind of understand what it is that we're dealing with. But I think part of that kind of like blindness to the moment, also the important thing to remember, especially when looking at, say, emerging artists' work, is why it could be new. You know, it's so easy to look at something and say, like, well, this was done by so-and-so a decade ago, and dismiss it and not understand why it could have importance or value in the moment, you know, in that moment that it's created, like, in this, like, very time. And so it's almost the more you see, the harder it is sometimes to see what's new about something. And for myself, it's like as I'm looking at things, I try to remind myself of that, of like, don't dismiss something that you've seen for the first time just because it looks like so and so, you know, but rather it's like, okay, then why would someone make it now, or what is unique about that project or what that artist is putting out, in order to kind of see it for what it is.
Anything, Tschaba?
Yeah, I was going to say that for myself, I'm the kind of person that really believes you only have control over your own behavior, you know, and what you can do. So I really try to hold myself to like a high standard, to like seek honesty from myself and like really put that into my artwork, and I hope from that can, I guess, inspire other people to be kind of radically honest with themselves as well. My artwork is somewhat myopic in terms that it's pulled from a lot of my own personal experiences, but I think in like trying to seek a real truth in that it can be something that's universal. A lot of my work deals with the mundane, like the quotidian, like the everyday. But again, I feel like if you really mine those experiences, there's something political there, there's something spiritual there, there's something that is just speaks to humanity there as well. So that's been my approach to it. I don't generally make work about like individual political events, but I just more make work about my own life and kind of me trying to understand my own life process, and I'm hoping that maybe other people can find something of value in that. Just seeking a real honesty through my individual pieces.
Yeah, and I think for me, as an institution of philanthropy, what has really evolved in the last few years as a social justice philanthropy, in part to acknowledge that one of the failings of philanthropy is that we have not moved as a sector from an orientation of charity and generosity to one of dignity and justice, and to name that. As an institution, and to, I don't fund artists. I mean, I don't, you know, I mean, I was at a dinner with Bill T. Jones the other night, and we were talking about this very issue of how hard it was for Bill to raise money when he was starting the company, because he was political, because he was so out, and it was offensive to some dance funders, traditional dance funders, and others. It wasn't that it was offensive, it was that they just didn't understand what he was doing. And I think, you know, I'm proud that we were one of the first funders of Bill's work and have continued to fund his work and other artists, because I actually believe that if you fund artists, because artists, I look at it a little differently, Chris, because I actually think artists are foregrounding things that the general public isn't prepared to accept or really engage in, and so they are actually ahead of people, which is why they are so they're so disruptive and often so so marginalized, because they're holding the mirror up. And so I can think about artists who were doing work on what we now call gender-based violence. I mean, Carrie Mae Weems' early work on the plight, the state of Black women. I mean, we're all talking about that, but Carrie was by herself. And I mean, you know, and I think about Leonardo Drew's early work around mass incarceration, and I don't even think, well, actually Michelle Alexander had written a book on coining the term, you know, mass incarceration, and bringing to the fore at a time when the public thought about our justice system as a public safety and crime issue. And I think what Michelle was able to do, and Brian Stevenson and others, was to say, actually, this needs to be reframed as an issue of over-incarceration of Black and brown people in this country. And that was a total, but artists were doing that, right? Artists were already doing that. And so I actually think, for me, it's not that hard. I mean, if you have mechanisms to fund artists, to fund individual fellowships, to fund exhibitions of challenging work, of difficult work, and to encourage institutions, particularly institutions that without giving them money, probably wouldn't do it, to say, all right, raising the money is not a problem. Here's the money. Now, why aren't you exhibiting it? Because that's not an excuse. So anyway, that's sort of how I look at it. Any last words from the two of you from where you sit? It's Freeze Week here. I know you're both like, ugh. No, it's freeze week in New York. And for those of you who, please go right in. For those of you who are lovers of art, it's the big art fair. And artists and curators, depending on from where they sit, look at this week with trepidation. We've got one question and then you're going to answer it all. Yes, ma'am.
Hey, thank you so much for having this amazing event. Yay. So I'm Kanani Aya Holder. I'm an activist, I'm an educator, and a comedian. Go figure. And so my company is called Black Issues Issues. So I want everybody to look around and see and look at and answer this question. What's missing? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just answer it in your head silently. What is missing in this room? Just think. And I always think that I discipline myself. What is missing? What stories are not being told? What voices are not being heard? There's no children in here. Mm-hmm. So I used to be the director of arts at a charter school, and I would do this. I was like, yo, it's 4:00. Who's coming with me? And I would take them to Ford Foundation, the Public Theater, I lectured at MAD, Museum of Art and Design. Who's coming with me? I curated something at Apollo Theater, Family Programming and Engagement. Who's coming with me? I even forward this to principals to come to this today. So I'm always thinking, this is wonderful, and we're hoity-toity, and we're drinking wine. But we are not inviting children to be a part of this conversation so that the next generation of prime can be primed to be here and to be in this book. So what are all of you doing to prime the next generation?
Well, I would just say as a practical matter, in this moment, how you invite children into public spaces is fraught. Mm-hmm. So just in this COVID moment, and we've experienced it because, as you know, we have various age groups visit, and it's just fraught. So, I mean, but let's just park that because that's just tonight, that's like an issue for a lot of parents and for a lot of organizations taking responsibility for their visitors. But I absolutely think that this question of how children and young people, especially young people who are not given the opportunity to be exposed to art and beauty. So for me, it's more of a framework of justice and who has an opportunity, who has access to it and who doesn't. So on the issue of young people and the arts, we know, even though sometimes people say, well, there's no arts education in the schools, or actually, there's not sufficient arts education in schools attended by low-income and black and brown children, but there's arts education in all the suburban schools, in all the private, the Brearleys and Chapins and Buckleys in New York. I mean, there's arts education everywhere. It's just the question of, are arts valued and invested in so that young people and low-income people of color, children of color, et cetera, do they have access? So to me, it's that fundamental question of are we pressing for that, and why, and again, who has access and who doesn't? I know we're going to have to go, but we have one final question, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes, perfectly.
Hi. My name is J.D. Meprevert. I'm an artist and curator as well, so seeing you all three today is inspiring to me. I had to write my question down. It's simple, I believe, but as complex as you would like to make it. It's what are some challenges you all face in your distinct areas of work, and how do you overcome them? When I see you all, I see bridges and stepping stones. And as an artist and curator myself, I'm always looking to learn what others are doing, and learning from their mistakes, especially. And so I think my question is, what are some lessons that you can pass on to artists who are in the middle of the career, curators, right, who are inspiring to curate, and or others who are aspiring to run their nonprofit organization?
Great.
Thank you.
Chris and Chaba, please.
You want to go, or do you want me to go?
Maybe you go, Chris. Sure. Even working for experience.
I don't know. You've been in it just as long. It's a good question. There's a lot of challenges. You know, I'm thinking about Darren talking about Freeze Week, and there's a lot of distractions this week just because there's a lot of people in town and things that are happening. So I feel like one of the things is, like, don't burn out. You know, you have to kind of listen to your own body. And also, don't get distracted. You know, it's easy to say that it's like, oh, it's all fun because we're all here having wine and this and that, you know, but then part of it is the work and discipline, you know, whether as an artist being in the studio or as a curator to, like, make sure you're going out and seeing things and it's not just showing up to the party, even though that's a lot of fun and important, you know, but, like, you've got to put the work in too. It doesn't just come to you.
Yeah. I mean, I would agree with what Chris said, that you have to, I guess, put majority of your energy into your work, despite the entertaining, and sometimes it's also kind of, I guess, a work element, like the social aspect of the art world. I'm also still a little bit intrigued about the question earlier about young people. Just me personally, like, I teach at Bard, and that's been a big part of my life the past 2 years. This is being an arts teacher and kind of being interacting with people who are very, very early on in their career. For me, it's been something that's been just replenishing, to work with people who are literally just learning how to make art and they're not involved with any of the other kind of noise that comes along with it, like not concerned about shows, getting into shows, selling work, none of that. They're just really contending with themselves and trying to become better makers. And again, as to the reason why I think a book is so important, a book is something that I think young people can interact with in a way that they can't always interact with, you know, environments that are sometimes more geared towards adults. Let that be an opening or a talk, something like this nature. But the arts industry, I think, is just kind of an odd industry in general. So I think it's hard to say, like, what's the right thing to do or the wrong thing to do, because so much of it really depends on the individual and what their temperament is, what their own personality is. But I just think it's important for people, if they have certain kind of boundaries or certain kind of goals that they personally want to reach, that they kind of just stay true to themselves. Because regardless of what happens, if you kind of stay true to whatever your original goal was, you know, you will, I think, be relatively content no matter how things turn out.
Great, great. And I just think we have to be better listeners. So thank you. Please join me in thanking Shava and Chris, and this wonderful book, Prime, Art's Next Generation, is available. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Darren.